Attendees are in listen-only mode.
Good afternoon or morning, everybody, depending on where you are in the world. And thank you for joining our great garment graphics presentation and CAD-CUT Q&A, all of your heat transfer film questions answered. I'm Josh Ellsworth with Stahl's CAD-CUT Direct, and I'll kind of be acting as the moderator in today's session and taking some of your questions that you have that you want to get answered, particularly on heat transfer films or really anything heat printing, and sending those off to our panel of experts here live on the line and hopefully giving you all the answers you need. We'll introduce our panel here momentarily, but before we get to that, just want to give you a rundown on how you can submit your question. So within your GoToMeeting flyout screen on the right-hand side of your computer, you should see a question box. If you start thinking of questions right now as we're going through introductions, or if you came with a list of questions, start typing them in to the box and just submit them to us, and we'll take as many as we can live online. Hopefully we'll get to all of them. I know some of you have already sent some stuff over, so that's great. This is part two of our CAD-CUT Q&A. We had one of these a month or two ago, and it went really well, and we have some of those same panelists back, as well as a new one today. So with that, I'm going to just introduce you to our expert panel. The first one that's on the line with us today is Russ Corey. Russ, can you tell us a little bit about yourself and your experience with heat printing?
Well, hopefully you guys can hear me. I had a little trouble earlier.
Yeah, we got you.
Great. I've been with the company about 15 years. Been real active in sports, hockey players, baseball. So a lot of experience in the sporting goods side. And just happy to answer any of your questions today.
Excellent. Well, thanks for joining us, Russ. Russ covers the territories of, as you see there, of Georgia, South Carolina, Alabama, Mississippi. So if you're located in those areas, you may know Russ already. If not, we'll make sure to follow up with you after the presentation to anybody in those territories. The next member from the Groupe Stahl Sales Alliance is Mark Schwab, and we welcome Mark back. And can you give us a little rundown for new attendees, Mark, of what your experience is?
I bring about 27 years at last count of sports apparel decorating and screen printing, embroidery, owned and operated a CAD-CUT machine going back to the very first days they were available. So I've been cutting and lettering sports uniforms primarily, but that led to numerous other products. So my heat press, my cutter, and full decorating facilities offers me a little bit of expertise in that area. Been with Groupe Stahl for five years now, and happy to help.
Excellent. And Mark represents the state of Florida for us. So if you're from Florida and you don't know Mark, please make sure to type in a question in today's presentation, and Mark will follow up with you afterwards. Also, we have Ken Chadwick back on the line with us today. Ken, can you give us a little background on yourself?
Sure. My name is Ken Chadwick, and I come from the decorated apparel industry background. I started out as a customer of Stahl some 28, 29 years ago, and I too had a background in the sporting goods business and morphed that into equipment sales for screen printing equipment, lasers, embroidery machines, etc. And I'd be happy to answer any questions on heat applied graphics or any decorated apparel.
Excellent. And Ken represents Northeast New York and Northeast U.S. There's too many states to list, but if you're in the northeastern part of the country, Ken is your guy. And once again, I'm Josh Ellsworth with Stahl's CAD-CUT Direct, which is the heat transfer film manufacturing division of Stahl's, and I've been with Groupe Stahl for close to 11 years now and in my current position with CAD-CUT Direct for the past 2 years. So with that, we're just going to kind of open it up to your questions. Feel free to type them in, keep them going. And we have our first question from Tim. And the question is, we have been just asked to decorate some reversible basketball jerseys. Does this pose a problem decorating on the inside and outside of the garment? Thanks. So let's throw that over to Mark to start things off.
Yeah, probably the worst subject you could start the program with. very tedious. Reversible basketball jerseys. If you're doing the front, then you're obviously doing the back, the inside, and the outside. I can take a guess that these are probably mesh, and then you have to avoid the pitfalls of having the two layers bond together when you heat the in and out of either the front or the back. So get yourself in line with plenty of pillows and Teflon sheets. You'll need them to insert. You will be pressing the back, let's say, flipping the uniform to press the front. But when you turn that inside out, then those two surfaces will be facing each other. If you were to heat press at that point, you would risk melting them together or welding them together. So you'll need to insert a pillow, most likely, between those two layers. And it becomes a little confusing on the phone, but you can envision that you're decorating four sides. And at some point in time, the two layers or the two facing sides are going to want to contact each other. So make sure you've got plenty of cover sheets and Teflon handy to help with that. The other thing you can do, I guess, is thread or dress the lower platen. The opening of the reversible's bottom hem should be open enough for you to slide them on in a dressing fashion over your platen, and then you won't be risking bonding those layers together. You shouldn't have any problem with materials. Most reversibles are polyester. Some might still be made out of nylon, but we've got CAD materials for all of that. And it'll be slow. Make sure you charge enough for it.
Excellent. Thanks for those tips. And Tim bounced back with the fact that he has a fusion, which for those attending today, that's the press in the bottom left of your screen. I don't know if you can tell from a picture, but it's completely threadable on that press. You don't need to mess with pillows or pads. If you're lucky enough to have a fusion press or one of our new heat press caddies, you can actually open that garment up, as Mark references, and just thread it onto the bottom platen. If the jerseys are too small, then you need to get an interchangeable lower platen, which they're really quick to change on that fusion, as I'm sure you know by now, Tim. So there's a follow-up to that question, and I'm going to throw it over to Russ. Tim says, since my client wants a basketball jersey, what film would you recommend me using? Again, I have to apply the film to the inside and the outside of the jersey. Thanks. So what heat transfer film?
Going on that reversible basketball jersey, a lot of times they're going to be two different materials. One side's going to be polyester, and the other side's going to be nylon. So you want to double-check and make sure that you have either the same or two different issues there with the materials. So in that case, if you're going with the polyester, you can use a wide variety of the materials, like the sport film white, thermal film. Either one of those are going to work real good for you. On the nylon side, you really want to go with the thermal grip. It's a little bit more aggressive on the adhesive. It's going to bite into that nylon and hold real well for you.
Excellent. Thank you. And then while we're on this, Ken, there's a follow-up question that came in from Lou. And Tim may run into this on his polyester-based reversibles. Lou asks, please explain dye migration and how to prevent it. Can you add anything to that, Ken?
Sure. Dye migration is usually when the heating element is too hot. It forces the dye out of the shirt to the top. Sometimes it's a question of adjusting the pressure downward or lowering the heat. The colors that are the most difficult to work with typically are in the red family, cardinal, maroon, crimson, or the real dark colors like black and navy blue. Sometimes when you heat press around, let's say, a white graphic, you might have a tinge of the black, the navy, or the red bleeding into the CAD print, if you will. So you want to do a couple of things. One is you want to make sure that you're lowering the temperature, and maybe when your choice of a CAD print material, if you know this is going to happen or if it starts to happen, you might want to have a CAD-CUT material that applies at a lower temperature. Sometimes our stated pressures, time, temperature, and pressure, sometimes is used as a guideline. Sometimes you have a wiggle room of a few degrees either way where you can actually lower the temperature and the CAD-CUT material will still apply to your garment. Another thing you might consider is if you're doing reversibles and you have the fusion, have a quick slip pad protector on the bottom platen, which makes the ease of putting the shirt on and off that much easier, as opposed to the shirt material fighting the silicone pad on the lower platen.
Yeah, that's a really great point, Ken, is when you're working you know, reversible, maybe not as big of a deal, but when you start to get into some of these performance fabrics, those have a tendency to be tough to slide on a platen without a quick slip pad protector, or even to snag underneath on the metal parts of the platen. So if you don't have that accessory on your heat press, it makes life a lot easier. I also add to that, Russ recommended a thermofilm or thermogrip, depending on whether it's polyester or nylon. And both of those are what I would call low bleed formulas, which mean they do a really nice job of preventing dye migration at their standard application. So they're not the thinnest, lightest weight material choices that are available, but if you're looking for something, you know, tried and true for athletic lettering that blocks migration, you won't really have an issue at all with thermofilm or thermogrip. There's some follow-up questions that are coming in here. Can thermogrip go on polyester? I would prefer to use the same material if possible. And I'll just, it's a really quick, easy answer on that one. The answer is yes. You'll end up overpaying a little bit for thermogrip to go on polyester, but if you want to just order, you know, one stock or one roll, thermogrip can definitely adhere to nylon and poly. Okay, so let's switch to a new question here. I have a question coming in from Guy. How were the men's and women's names and numbers for the Olympic volleyball uniforms get made? Anybody want to chime in on some ideas for some of the stretch volleyball uniforms that may have been used on the Olympic jerseys?
Well, they were heat pressed. I'll take it. I'm a volleyball fanatic by family. My best guess is without an up close view that it was a printed media, then heat pressed onto the jerseys. Mizuno did them. They're pretty well known to push the envelope and try out new things, and I have no doubt that they used a wide format print cut system, a media for bonding to the shirt. If I had seen a real close up and could tell that there perhaps was a twill material, then I would suggest that they may have run the twill through the same print cut system, cutted it and heated it. But in volleyball, you do want the stretch. In volleyball, you do want the lightweight. And those images of that chiseled look were almost certainly produced graphically on a wide format print system.
Okay, good. Yeah, and there's for the print cut systems that utilize solvent or eco-solvent inks, we do have some choices at CAD-CUT Direct. One is Solutions Opaque that's used by a wide variety of large sportswear manufacturers, so that's a good product for stretch. And then likewise, there's stretch products for CAD-CUT, as Guy has found out with his other question here. It looks like he's experienced a little bit with our Premium Plus heat transfer film, which is great for single color or, you know, one, two color number applications. And his question is it possible to get a little more tack on the Premium Plus material? It would help on finer detail and help when you need to keep the registration straight. So do any of you guys want to try that one, or do you want me to take a shot at it?
Oh, I think that one's for you, Josh.
Okay. Yeah, we won't filter your questions. Whether they're good or bad, we're going to address them. That's a great thing about this session. So Guy has some very valid feedback in that he's asking for this Premium Plus to have a little more tack on it. To be honest, it's something that we have explored and continue to explore. The problem is when you launch a product, you have about 50% of people, in this case, that love it and are reordering a lot of it and like the low-tack carrier specifically for stacking pre-cut stuff and also for ease of pulling when weeding large names and numbers. But you're right, it's not a perfect solution for fine detail at all, in that it's tough to hold fine detail onto a low-tack carrier. You want something more sticky like, for instance, fashion film. Now, there's trade-offs with any material. I would say, is it possible to get a lot more tack on Premium Plus? Yes, it's possible. However, I don't see it as being something that's on the timeline for the immediate future, and I'd probably point you in the direction of fashion film for your fine detail. Doesn't have quite as much stretch as Premium Plus, but has good flexibility. It's still really soft on the garment and a matte finish, so you may just try that. Another question regarding Premium Plus that has come across is somebody's having an issue with the blade skipping on Premium Plus and kind of putting a perforated cut on the material. How can I fix this, or can it be fixed? tips, tricks for stopping perforated cuts on vinyl cutters, guys?
I'd slow the speed down. It'd probably be the first thing I do.
Okay, speed. So, yeah, the rolling cuts at 50 centimeters per second. If you're using a rolling cutter for Premium Plus and high stretch materials, you want to drop it down to about 25 at least. You guys see anything else?
Blade exposed. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, go for it, Mark.
It's Mark. Maybe a little less blade exposed. You may be pushing the blade through the material and then dragging it along the carrier, and a high-end, high-quality blade. I think that's been most of the feedback is that you just need to cut it and really give a high-end blade a shot.
Okay. Yeah, we have the premium Dura blades, and you know they last about as three times as long as a standard blade, and they're double the cost, so your value is actually better on those. And yeah, when I've had technical issues on cutting stretch materials, I always recommend that Dura blade, and I addressed one just as lately as this past week for a gentleman in Ohio that completely did the issue. He tried to replace his cutting strip. In some cases, it could be a blade holder, and you need to clean that blade holder out with the pipe cleaner to make sure there's nothing in there from preventing the blade from turning freely. But in most cases, if you go to that premium blade and dedicate it to your stretch fabric so you're not wearing it down on like reflective and glitter materials, you'll be just fine. Okay, so the next question, I'm going to send this one over to Russ. This is pretty general. We can go a lot of different directions. I own an embroidery business and I'm looking to expand my capabilities. Where should I start with heat transfer?
Well, first place you want to start is you want to get a good press. Once you have the press, you got to really take a look at your business and see what your customers are asking for. If they're asking for cast and you're turning that business away because it's too hard to set up on your machine, or you don't have the cap set up, well, then obviously you might want to lean toward a cap press. If your customers are asking for, you know, uniforms or names and numbers and things like that that are just too big and cumbersome to embroider, well, then you want to look at a shirt press and maybe even like the Stahl's player names and numbers as a service. But I think your customers are really going to dictate where you need to expand. Unless you're really looking at attacking a new market, and then that market itself will dictate what kind of machine and what products you want to offer.
Okay, great. And then, Ken, from your background in embroidery, what's the easiest expansion you see with heat printing?
Well, I see in the Northeast, in the cold weather, sometimes it's a very popular canvas type jacket. Brand name is like a Carhartt jacket, which a lot of people are familiar with in the construction industry. And it's very difficult to hoop. The material is thick with a quilt lining, and the canvas is tough. Somebody with a heat press can put it inside a heat press for about 12 to 15 seconds. The heat softens the canvas, and the pressure compacts the quilt lining, which makes it infinitely easier to hoop. So, I agree with Russ. There's a lot of ways that you can go. You can also do multimedia where you embroider on a fabric and then heat press it onto your garment, or multimedia where you heat press onto like a chino or a twill, and you can heat press a graphic onto it. A digital print is very inexpensive, and make a small left chest logo with about 100 stitches. It looks like $1 million, and it costs you less than $4 to produce and apply. You put it on a $16 sweatshirt, and you're looking at a $45 item.
Perfect. Mark, any applications that you see for embroiderers and heat printing that jump out?
Yeah, I'll join those two comments together and say that with the addition of a heat press and the embroiderers that have hard-to-hoop items, let's just say bags or backpacks where zippers and pouches and things may be problematic in getting the hoop going, like Ken said, with a heat press you can press any number of graphics and decorations, anything that you may want to cut on your own, have us cut for you. Anything that you want to have us print in unlimited color, and then heat press. I think you can just get a lot more things under a heat press for application than you can in your hoops for embroidery application.
Okay, excellent. All good tips. And this prompted a lot of follow-up questions from different folks, one of which asks, I have embroidery and a vinyl cutter that can cut twill. At least I'm told it can. Where do I get started getting into applique? Somebody want to do the three-minute summary of cutting twill and applique?
You want me to take that?
Go for it.
Usually on a vinyl cutter, the twill would be sampling or very small runs where you can physically cut the twill on many vinyl cutters. You do need to exchange the blade out for a different angle blade that would cut through the twill because the twill would be a thicker material. But you then need to have embroidery software or extra software like Twill Stitch Pro that Stahl's offers to create the sew disc to actually sew the embroidery onto your garment, whatever you're doing. So typically people are not doing huge runs on the vinyl cutter. My own opinion is if you're doing something like, you know, 36 to 46 pieces a month, something like that, if you're doing something in higher volume than that, then you might want to consider an I-Line 300, which is a flatbed cutter, which you can cut twill in layers. So you can do what's called a kiss cut. So you could cut like red on blue on one during one time so you wouldn't have to register the second color. When you're doing it on a vinyl cutter, you have to register and cut color one. Then you have to cut and register color two by using the sew disc software through either your embroidery company or software like Twill Stitch Pro. And obviously you can put applique on anything that will be able to withstand the weight of the applique material. So you're probably not going to be doing this on a T-shirt, but it would be a terrific application for anything nylon or for a sweatshirt material.
Yeah, and thanks, Ken. And just for those of us that are maybe beginners, applique is basically probably, let's think of like an authentic NFL jersey where the numbering sewn on out of the tackle twill material. Applique is actually the process of sewing that twill to the garment to give you a finished applique. That usually uses a zigzag stitch, and then there's opportunity to do some other stuff with applique, with different types of satin stitches that are a little fuller for like a fleece and things like that. And Donna actually has a follow-up question that fits well here. She says, you were talking about cutters and different blades. I was wondering what suggestions, if any, you would have to cut satin fabric with a cutter. Russ or Mark?
Go ahead, Russ.
Well, satin fabric, typically it's not going to be made to be run through a cutter. So it's going to be a real slippery material, so I would start with either the twill blade or the 60-degree blade, and I would go with one of the higher density or the higher quality blade there, just so that you know that you're getting the best cut possible. We do have a magic mask that you could try and coat that or apply that material to and do some small cuts. But, again, I would test it before you even think that you can produce it because that material just may not stick to that and give you anything that you can cut worthwhile.
Okay, Dawn, and I've sent a follow-up question to you just if you could clarify what type of vinyl cutter you have. That would help us in answering that question. And then she just put a follow-up comment. I do Irish dance and costume embroidery, and sometimes there are many of the same applique, so I would like to cut it. And she says a cutter brand name here is amazing, the brand name of the cutter? Yes.
Could be a relabel. On that particular thing, if you're doing lots and lots of the same logo, you could send that material into Stahl. We could coat it and cut it for you. And that would just depend on what your actual quantity is and how often you need them. But that might be something to try as well, just use us as a service.
Okay. We will cut your fabric, Donna, to answer your follow-up question. So that's an opportunity there. I'm not familiar with that brand of cutter, but on most roll-style cutters where you load a roll of material, where it's an option to load a roll of material, they don't do a particularly great job of cutting fabrics that aren't very stable, like twill. Twill they do nicely, but satins and soft cottons, they don't do a good job. For those, you usually want a flatbed style cutter or a laser style cutter, which is what we have at Stahl's and have capacity to help you cut your fabrics. Lou asked another question here on a different topic. any tips or tricks for lining up left chest logo, no matter what the size? Sometimes the logo ends up too close to the armpit.
I'll take it.
Good.
If it's just a T-shirt and there's no button plackets to use as a reference point, I used to have my employees snap the imaginary line from the junction where the armpits panels all come together. You give that a good tug, you'll sort of create a line. You as the owner, the boss, have to determine whether or not you want your employees or whomever to position the logo, let's say, you know, 2 fingers widths above that, 3 fingers widths above that, and also look at the center line. A lot of people tend to put left chest logos too far to the left and to the right. It actually is more to the inside of the shirt than most people think. If you have a button placket, you may suggest that your employees use a particular button as an alignment across the shirt. You want maybe half the logo above that button, half the logo below it. Maybe the base of the placket can serve as a good reference point and tell your employees or what have you to put the logo entirely above that line. You could get crazy with lasers and things like that. There are laser beams that can be shot across a shirt from off to the side. But honestly, you can make a guide yourself and put it in writing, tape it near your heat press, and just ask that the folks operating the heat press follow your guidelines. So if you start doing some shirts at 10 in the morning and somebody else comes in and starts to finish those same shirts, that you're all working from the same directive.
Okay. Yeah, I really like the tip about, you know, going from the center of the shirt. So if you even press a crease or measure from the center of the neck or the tag down and have a spec that you're going to establish to come off of the center of the shirt, with the way shirts are cut, you know, the center is pretty consistent in a measurement. If you start measuring from, you know, the sleeve or the side of the shirt and the way that there's so many different styles of garments, you'll never get any sort of consistency that way, and you'll have some that'll be too close to under the arm or on the side, et cetera. Okay.
It's slightly different, but you guys want to hear a quick little tip there.
Yeah, please. Please.
I take the shirt, and I'll fold it right at the bottom side of the armpit. And so as I'm holding the shirt on each end, I bring those together to give me my center. So, and then I give that a little pinch right in the center. And that draws a little, like a plus sign, right in the center of the shirt. And I go about 3 fingers width inside of that as my left chest. If you look at any T-shirt or any short sleeve or pocketed shirt, it's usually about 2 to 2.5 inches where the pocket starts from the placket. So you're really pretty close to the center.
Okay. Excellent. We may have to do a video with you there, Russ. So we can publish that out on a great garment graphics site to show how that works. That's something we can put on our calendar.
It's pretty easy and pretty simple. It's about a 10-second video.
Great.
In the old days, they used to do the Pledge of Allegiance and have a piece of Taylor's chalk between your middle finger and your ring finger. It's kind of simple. Some people used to use something similar to a formula like down 6 and over 4, like on a men's large. You'd go down 6 inches, which would bring you close to the bottom of the placket, and then over 4 inches to get to the center. But, you know, everybody does it differently, and some people today actually have little lasers that they purchased. They actually put them on their heat presses, or some of the embroidery machines today have little laser dots so you can, you know, line up the center of the hoop with the center of your shirt. But everybody's got a different formula. Whatever works for you, and you don't want to put it under the armpit.
Okay, great. So we're at about halftime of our Q&A today. So what I'd like to encourage you to do is take a deep breath, think of some other questions that may have a hard time coming to you, and type some more in. We are getting a few still coming in, but nowhere near what we started off with. We're going to continue on the path here, but please type in more questions. Another question here. This is good. It talks about seeing stuff in person. And the question is, what trade show should I go to in order to see this stuff in person and pick up techniques like this? Any trade show recommendations? Let's go around the horn, starting with Mark.
Being that we're in Florida, or I'm in Florida, ISS is always in Orlando, Imprinted Sportswear Show, Orlando. It's not too far up the I-75 to Atlanta, ISS hosts a show in Atlanta coming up in September, by the way. And any of the MBM shows, I guess, you can travel to if you happen to want to wrap a vacation around Las Vegas or others. But I believe the two major trade publications in the industry, Printwear Magazine and Impressions Magazine, also host some of the better trade shows out there, too.
Okay, Russ?
Well, Mark stole mine with saying Atlanta, which is the Atlanta ISS, September 7th and 8th. But, you know, any of the shows that we're at, you're going to see the equipment. You're going to have all of the experts on hand to give you those tips and tricks. So I'd really say any show that we're at is a good one.
Okay, excellent. You can get that list from stalls.com. Ken, do you have any recommendations different than what we've said?
Yeah, I think Salvas also supplement these shows. Many times the clothing distributors will have their own shows specifically to their customer base, and they'll invite non-competitors to that show. And since Stahl's is not selling the apparel, on the East Coast sometimes it's Broder Brothers, Alpha, New England Sportswear, et cetera. We will go to their shows, and they're pretty well attended. We also supplement by having small hotel shows. Many of the reps in different territories would offer a hotel show, or we might have a facility in California, Phoenix, Ohio, where people from those territories can go. They're all listed on the events page on both Stahl's and Transfer Express. And I've actually put in boot camps, as I know some of the other reps have as well, where we'll have, like in a day, we'll have two or three two-hour classes. They're free, and we'll go through the different materials, applications, and customers are free to bring their questions and their challenges to us. The major trade shows are great, but when there's 10,000 people there, you know, you can't expect to get a half hour on your particular topic.
Right. Yeah, that's a good point. I'll add just a few other unique things coming up in October. The SGIA show is sgia.org. That is in Las Vegas, and Stahl's will have a big booth there, and we're actually putting on an educational program there within the booth where it's like sit-down classroom style, so that's a really good one if you want to plan a destination trip to Vegas. Also, soon on our website, we'll be announcing a D3 event, which is Design, Decorate, Deliver, that we'll be having in Ohio, which is basically a full-day open house just outside of Cleveland, Ohio, where we have limited seating. It's going to be $50 per company, up to two people. And, you know, we have a really great educational schedule there where you can test drive heat presses. I'll be giving some sessions. Dane Clement will be giving some artwork sessions. And there's a lot of other speakers as well. So if you're anywhere near Ohio, pencil off September 12th on your calendar. I think that'll be a great one for you all. Okay, so... more industry questions. We recently upgraded to a rolling cutter. Any suggestions on places to sell used cutters? I think this one's pretty easy. You know, you can go on eBay and list it. You can, you know, go to a trade show typically and find somebody looking for a cutter and sell your cutter there as you're networking. You can also utilize places like t-shirt forums in the classified section to list your cutter for sale. So those would be a few. And then Deborah types in also Digit Smith, DigitSmith.com is another place to sell used equipment. Okay, back into the product questions. This is a question about one of our hottest selling materials, Glitter Flake. Will your Glitter Flake material work on a mesh fan jersey? Any of you guys, feel free.
Sure, as long as it's polyester.
Yeah, that's a good point. The Glitter Flake has a polyester adhesive, so as long as it's polyester, it's no problem, even if it's mesh. Just take some of the precautions that we opened up with and you know, making sure you put a pillow or thread that garment to prevent the layers from sticking together if it's a mesh fan jersey. And you can, I mean, this is just my thought, but you can get these fan jerseys from a lot of different places, so I know you guys have deep contacts in the sporting goods world, so why don't we just go around the horn and recommend some team uniform suppliers. I think we did this last time as well. Mark, if you can give us some recommendations.
Let's see. I always refer to Cobblestones. I repped them for a little while. They're in Ogden, Salt Lake City, Utah, They will do customs. So if you do have a school that wants to have you provide a jersey in their school, particular colors, say a body of red with black side panels, or a body of gold with black shoulder cowling area, that's one source. Game gear by Cobblestones. You could go to Holloway. Holloway and Augusta, owned by the same parent company, both have been in sports uniforms for a while now, so they will be more stock, but they have them. Of course, your usual A4 Badger. Without getting too far into the whole custom realm of things, you may or may not be able to access a lot of the larger brands, depending on what you may or may not be able to get into Under Armour, Nike, and Reebok, but there's plenty of product out there for the fan wear sector.
Okay. Russ or Ken, anything to add to that?
You know, the big guys, Russell, Rawlings, Champion, Wilson, sometimes they'd have stocking requirements. So if you're only doing like one or two teams a year, you're probably better off dealing with either a distributor where you don't have to have the stocking requirements, or an opening order of $10,000 or something like that.
I'll throw in Allison in Rochester, New York.
Yeah, Don Allison.
I think they've opened up a little bit more of a liberal policy to selling their products out more widely. Those are the first three that come to mind. If you have any more that give me a little bit more time, I can come up with several more.
No, I think that's a pretty extensive list for people to start. And the only other one, I'm not, you may have said it, but Bowmark out of Ohio, they're actually be at our open house showing some of their sportswear as well. We have another
one. Teamworks.
Yeah, Teamwork Athletic is very good. Okay. Tony has a question regarding sourcing of products. What is best for a stiff canvas bag? He wants to know what heat transfer vinyl is best for a canvas bag. Russ, do you have any recommendations there?
Well, yeah. If it's a cotton canvas, you're pretty wide open. Thermal film is a good one. If it's a real heavy mesh, or not a heavy mesh, but a heavy weave, the thicker material is going to fit a little bit nicer. So thermal film is probably my favorite on a real thick canvas. But again, cotton base, you've got it wide open. If it's nylon base, well, then now you're going back to probably either Gorilla Grip or Thermal Grip, depending on the weave.
Yeah, I think a lot of people are intimidated by, you know, different things that don't say cotton or polyester, but like canvas being a cotton-based product, and even like can koozies with neoprene being polyester-based surface. There's a lot of options within the lineup that will stick to some of these things that are perceived as difficult that aren't really tough for our adhesives. Okay, here we go. Tim's following up on the reversible jersey, and I knew this question would come, especially when Mark said that you have to decorate four sizes, make sure you charge enough. So Tim asked, I know this is rather subjective, but when I price the basketball jersey and in essence decorating the four sides, inside and outside, how would you suggest determining the cost? Any cost experts on our panel today?
Depends on how many you're doing. Are you doing a team or are you doing a league? Many people would double the price of the graphics and then add in a cost. I believe we have a materials calculator online. We still have that, Josh?
Yes.
And so you could figure out the cost of your graphic by using the material calculator. And in some cases, they also had an Excel spreadsheet, so you could put in the cost of the garment, the cost of the four graphics, put in your markup, put in your labor, and you'd have your pricing. But you're right, it is very subjective, but you know, you have to get compensated for your time. You don't want to work for free.
I'll
expand on that, since I'm the one that made the comment about make sure you charge enough for it. When I made that comment, I meant to make sure you cover your time. You're going to spend an awful lot of extra time turning the shirt inside and out, inserting pillows, removing pillows, paying extra care. It's just going to slow down your entire process. Make no mistake that you can take a T-shirt, heat press the front, flip the T-shirt, heat press the back, and be done with it. When you're dealing with a reversible, it is an entirely slower process. You can easily double the price of the jersey in most cases. Add up all of your numbers and do what you want with it. I don't know how you're going to decorate a team name or what have you with that, but do not discount your extra labor. You're going to spend an inordinate amount of time on those jerseys as compared to everything else you've ever heat pressed.
You know, remember your competitor.
What I'd say, what I would say, Tim, just to add here, when you were talking before about using thermogrip or thermofilm, if you're planning to cut all of this yourself because it's a custom font or something like that, then you know it's pretty easy to figure out the cost. But if you're sticking to a stock font, which I would recommend to keep things easy, like Varsity or Pro Block or something we offered pre-cut numbers in, you're going to reduce your cost greatly by ordering, you know, like a team pack from us or the pre-cut numbers that you need to decorate this. And also, given the fact that you have the Fusion, and I'm assuming you have it loaded with a quick slip, you should be able to actually take that garment without taking it completely off and spin it on the platen to do, you know, front back on, let's say, the white side of the reversible, and then obviously you got to take it off and reload it. You can do front back by spinning it on the black side of the reversible. But the cool thing about thermofilm is it's a short application time, as is thermogrip, of 8 seconds. So, you know, I still think there's money to make on this job for sure. It's you can actually charge quite a bit and make quite a bit of margin on this.
Don't forget that your competitor potentially is not using a vinyl cutter and they are screen printing this garment. So they would have to make a screen, at least probably two anyway, and then they would have to run it, change the color, run it, put the second screen, change the color. So there's four runs, a minimum pricing of two screens, four runs through the dryer, and they still have not put a number on it. So if you figure out what the cost to screen print it, what it would be, and figure out what the cost would be to do it with the vinyl cutter, you know, the labor is your variable, just like the screen printer has to charge for the screen charge and run it through the dryer, and yet he still has to probably heat press the names and numbers.
Great. And then Deborah, go for it, Mark.
Sorry, Josh. But this subject really sticks with me because I did so many of them. Heaven forbid if it's two color. If it's two color, give me a call and I'll explain my way through, through that.
Okay. All right. And then, Deborah, you asked, actually, it was one of the first questions, I'm sorry I overlooked it, is about the pricing spreadsheet for the different types of vinyl that I think Ken or Mark had referenced a moment ago. We do have that available, so if you want a copy of that heat transfer film cost calculator, just go ahead and type in the brand of heat transfer film that you currently use the most of, or maybe the few brands that you use, and submit it over in the questions box, and we'll send you that calculator within 24 hours after this session ends. Tim, hey, Mark, Tim does say it's two color, so this is a dream job for him here.
I'll gladly give out my cell phone number and he can call me if you like.
I'll reply to him with your, or actually, if you want to say your cell phone number over the line, go for it.
It's no problem, yeah. 954-599-8660.
Margo has a question. I'm seeing fabric blends with, I guess you pronounce this, model, M-O-D-A-L. How do you pronounce that, guys? Fabric
M-O-D-A-L.
Blends with model and viscose. Which vinyl should be used for these? Anybody have any experience with that stuff? I do not.
No, I don't.
I have not heard those two words in fabric surrounding.
Okay, Russ seems to have some info.
Is that viscous, V-I-S-C-O-U-S?
Yeah, viscous.
Yeah, so I'm about 90% sure that's polyester based. We should be okay there.
Okay. Yeah, Margo, I guess if you want to send a more specifics on the garment, maybe a photo of it to the Great Garment Graphics folks through their blog, we'll see if we can't do some research in our lab and come up with a good recommendation for you. We don't have one right now, unfortunately.
And the fabric content would be important.
Yeah. Okay, so another question coming through, and we'll wrap it up here with a couple questions. I'm doing porthole mesh practice jerseys for football. What vinyl should I use?
Take it. Since they're portholes, somebody's probably looking for a bargain. And since they are practice, you probably want something heavy and durable, econo print, or thermofilm.
Okay. Any issues with the large holes on that mesh with either of those two products, or we should be fine?
You should be fine. They'll probably close the holes and stay intact. If you go to some of the thinner materials, you might clear the holes if that's the effect they want.
Okay.
But Premium Plus, I have not worked with, but it would give me an impression that it might clear the holes. But again, porthole jerseys are normally a practice item. They're looking for price. You pick up a porthole jersey, I guess nowadays in the $550, $595 range, you want to keep the price decorated with numbers as low as you can.
Okay, that's great.
There's still the vinyl available, too, the paperback vinyl.
Yeah, we have a product that probably not a lot of you know about that's just called vinyl, which is actually a heat transfer PVC-based vinyl that works on porthole mesh jerseys. But if it were me, I'd probably go towards the thermofilm as well. It's just simpler, and there's more advice and experience out there for that product. Okay, so let's just get into a few trend questions and leave these folks with some tips, some of the things I came up with that I thought would be beneficial to our audience to ask. One of the questions I had for you is, with fall sports approaching, what are some looks that you recommend for those that attended today for showing in their shop or taking out on sales calls? Any looks you're recommending for people to show this fall?
The CAD-CUT H2O, definitely using the super film and keeping it under increased pressure and higher heat to make it look like discharge ink, water-based screen printing. People seem to like that look and the feel of it for cotton products, either lights or darks.
Mm-hmm.
Multimedia for the girls for cheerleading spirit wear, where you might be putting, glitter with multiple colors where you have the outline of a cheerleader and, you know, maybe a star or stars and doing everything in, say, silver and then having a backdrop with two or three inserts for a red star.
Okay. Russ, any tips?
Typically for samples, I like to show kind of like the value meal type plan. If you're selling T-shirts, you know, just put a sample on a bag. Sell more products. Kind of mix it up. Again, go to the mixed media and show things that are a little different that you can charge more for.
Okay. Mark?
Since the subject was fall and I'm in Florida, I'll just talk to the rest of the country about cooler weather. Look into distressed applique. Don't be afraid of applique and twill lettering on hoodies and the other winter wear that's out there. It appears difficult to do. It's not. But the appearance of it being difficult can also allow you to make more margin on the retail end of it. So order a sample kit of our distressed applique or a sample kit of our regular cut twill and give it a try in your embroidery machine.
Okay, excellent. And, one of the hottest products I've seen in a long time, I mentioned earlier, has been Glitter Flake. And one of the things that I promised attendees today, if they came on our Facebook page, that we would show them how to utilize Glitter Flake for a multicolor application where it looks like it's overlapping layers using what's called a trapping technique. So I'm just going to veer off of our presentation screen here for a second and go to CorelDRAW. And I just show you a visual. Take care. Great design out of Glitter Flake, where we were going to show the red, white, and blue on top of a black layer, or whatever colors you want to insert here. With Glitter Flake and its application, you're technically not allowed to put layer on layer, which means for the background, I couldn't go with a full background like I would normally do for something like Thermofilm or Premium Plus or something like that. You have to do what's called a trapping technique. And for those of you that are screen printing, you're probably familiar with this in the art setup process. But the trapping technique is actually really simple, where you actually create not only an offset to the artwork, but you also create an inset here on this layer. So if I zoom in, I'll just show you a quick example of how this would work. Got to drag my question box out of the way here for a second. You can see where I have this red layer and I've created the offset here. If I want to actually create an inset as well, I can go up to effects and add a contour to the inside of this design. And you can see this is an inside contour in Corel, and I can apply it, put it in, let's just say 0.1. Basically all I'm doing is creating an extension here of the black layer that's behind it. So basically you would create not only an offset for the outline color, but an inset as well. So when you finish creating the artwork and break these layers apart, I'll show you what the background would look like after you set it all up. And we'll do a more in-depth video on this, but I just want to show you a visual of how this may look. So when I cut this background layer, I'm actually going to have empty space here where the garment's going to show through when I press this down, and it's going to give me that like quarter inch or eighth of an inch gap for easy alignments. So when I go to press this background layer down and garment showing through, I can actually lay this directly over top. The reason why it's important that you do that offset or inset is so you don't get registration issues. So I'll show you a quick photo here of a potential bad registration. We did one bad so we could show you what happens. See, here's one where we didn't create the offset. And you see, like, we have the bottom layer of the confetti glitter flake, and we inlay what's actually the silver color here. You can actually see a gap space here in the garment showing through. But if you complete the artwork properly and give yourself that little trap, it should be just perfectly easy to press a bottom layer and then line up color by color for a really knockout result that I think will sell this fall. When you start to work with bling effects and glitter materials in particular, getting multiple colors all condensed together really tightly is a really hot-selling technique. And with that, I'm just going to also show you a quick little video. Hopefully, the computer keeps up with me here. This is just a 3-minute video that shows you the application of this. I'll kind of walk you through. You can see that's the background design that we've cut out. Courtney's actually doing the applications here for us, and we're just going to press the background of the glitter flake, in this case to a cotton dress. I believe it's from Alpha. And then let it cool down. And with our video editing techniques, we can cool it down automatically and peel away the backing. And I see the garment showing through, and then that's where we take the time, and that should line up exactly. You'll have to spend a little bit of time in the registration, so you want to make sure to charge for it. But you can see you can basically get it in there perfectly, feel around the edge to make sure you're not seeing any black show through and it's overlapping. And then ultimately she's going to line the blue layer up here since there's no mylar in the way. You guys that are watching this, Mark or Ken or Russ, is this keeping up okay?
Yeah, so far.
Okay. All right, so we're going to do the second layer down also for a few seconds. Let it cool down and peel away the backing. You know, if I were running a whole job, I would basically do all the background layers, wait till they cool down, peel it, and then come back on the press and press these additional layers. If you trim the mylar correctly, you can probably do all three foregrounds at once since they're not directly overlapping each other. And we'll inlay the silver, which actually looks like a white, next to the confetti color background, which is a darker silver with multicolor in it. And cover the whole thing and press it for one final application. So once again, you know, the reason I'm walking you through this is we had some questions on Facebook that I know some of you were asking and wanted to see this. And that trapping technique is something that's pretty useful when you can't layer material directly on top of itself. With this application, we just have a very small edge layered, and the material is primarily sticking to the garment, which should make for a really good-looking finished result. As you can see with the high-density glitter flake material, there's no space there. It's perfectly positioned. Okay. All right, so with that, we got 5 minutes left, and I'm going to ask the last question of the day. And this one is just a fun one. Usually I'd say leave everybody with one piece of advice, but I have something different. We're going to leave them with one idea, and we're going to use your experience in the field. So we'll start with Mark and go around the horn again. What is the most interesting job you have ever seen or heard of being completed with heat printing?
Interesting job. I saw bikinis get done with the image of skeleton hands. It was clever for the retailer, but I found it interesting because we were dealing with a lycra spandex product, which is problematic. It also was a lined product, which is also problematic for any kind of screen printing or embroidery. So pretty much heat press and cut vinyl is the only solution these folks had come up with. They had taken, like I said, the bones of a skeleton hand, placed it on the front of the bikini and the rear of the bikini, and a good effect. I don't know if it's a huge market, but it was interesting to see this person get through a dilemma using a cutter and a heat press when they couldn't have done practically anything else.
And I think that's a great idea. It's maybe a market for somebody in decorating swimwear. There's certainly possibilities with our heat transfer films there.
Yeah, I think the point was that they were able to do something on a heat press that you just could not get under any other kind of device.
Yeah. Russ, what do you have for us?
Well, I got a few. A lot of our products end up in places that you'd never even expect. We had a customer that's done some matting, that's heat applied on picture frame matting. I've got customers that actually use the Gorilla Grip to make waterproof seams. They actually lay it right over top and heat apply it over stitched seams, and that kind of forms a watertight seal. And the most, the one that's the most interesting to me, and everybody's seen it, is the fighting mats that are in the MMA fight, where you see all the advertisements. That's all our heat applied material. The one color stuff is just our solid CAD-CUT film, and the print colors, where there's lots of different colors on a particular logo, is our heat applied product.
Those are certainly interesting. Yeah, I think the matte thing is awesome. There's got to be a lot of margin in that, too.
Well, there's only one company that I know of that's making those mats for all of the fights. So they've kind of got the market cornered on that. But it's pretty neat to see it there.
Good. Ken, what do you have for us?
I dealt with a customer who was dealing with a motorcycle club, and the club's logo was the Chicago Bears. The Chicago Bulls logo, if you will. It was appliqued onto a leather jacket, and they used a vinyl cutter and a heat press to outline the appliqued logo with reflective material.
Wow. Onto leather.
Onto leather.
Yeah, once we have Bruce on here for one of these Q&A panels, he'll be able to really talk about some of the opportunities with leather applications, because he's a rider and everything else. But I think it's kind of like uncharted territory because people are afraid to do it, but it's certainly potential there with heat printing for leather if you practice and know what cover sheets to use.
Okay. It looks awesome. They actually sent me a picture of it at night with all the club members on their motorcycle.
Excellent. Yeah, so I'll throw in one idea as well, and this is kind of like, I guess, a nighttime concept with Halloween approaching. The glow-in-the-dark material has a lot of basic applications, but one of the more unique ways that I saw it being used is actually creating a glow design for kids. actually letting the kids put stickers onto the glow design, selling it with a pack of stickers, different shapes and silhouettes. They can actually sticker the glow design. The glow material charges when it's under light. So if they sticker the design and mom or dad charges it for, you know, let's say 3 or 4 hours before they get ready to go out trick-or-treating or out to a friend's house to play hide-and-seek or whatever, if you charge it and then basically remove the stickers once it's nighttime, those will be like blackout areas in the glow-in-the-dark design because they haven't charged. And the lines are really clean, and it's a really unique solution to make a shirt something that's more of a craft project and creative for kids' apparel. It may help you stand out. And there's some other unique things you can do with glow with laser lights where, you know, you can have a square box on a T-shirt and write on it with the blue light laser, and it kind of stands out, which has been popular with nightclubs and some other concepts. So thank you. All of you have stuck with us 100% of the time here today, so that must mean that you're liking the information you're getting, and we appreciate that and really love talking to you as customers. I want to thank Great Garment Graphics for hosting us today. Thank you, Mark, Russ, and Ken, for joining us for this hour to answer customers' questions. We will certainly have another one, so stay tuned for that. And until the next Great Garment Graphics webinar, you guys take care. Thank you.